Good evening, everyone. There's only two times where you can applause, and that's counting one. So, my name is Neil Levesque, and I'm part of a team here that runs the New Hampshire Institute of Politics at St Anselm College, and I'm out here to tell you a couple housekeeping things before we get started. First of all, on the applause, there is two opportunities, not counting that, when you can applaud, unless prompted by Jack Heath, the moderator. This is about the voters, so we want to make sure that there aren't disturbances out here, clapping, boos, hissing, you know. So the fact is try to keep it to yourself. We want to have a good forum here today, and it's about the voters again. Another housekeeping item, please stay in your seat. I know it's long, it's 2 hours, but if you could stay in your seat, if you stand up, you're in the way of one of these many television cameras, and you'll block that shot. So, using the restroom, I hope this is a good time for me to say that I hope they all already did that. So, if you do have to leave, they won't let you back in, but just so you know. The third thing, and most importantly, and I have a 13-year-old daughter, so I have to tell her this all the time, I need you to shut your cell phone off. I know that a lot of people, like my daughter, will hold it down here, and they'll start clicking. But the fact is we can hear those taps on these sensitive microphones, and the shine from the screen actually does affect the sensitive lights in here and what the TV picks up. So I'm going to ask you if you could shut your phone off. I know it's hard, it's 2 hours, but if you could do that for us, it'd be great. So for tonight's welcome, I would like to introduce to you Dr. Stephen DeSalvo, the president of St. Anselm College.
Thank you and welcome to St. Anselm College. Many of you have been here before for some of our Politics and Eggs events and speaker series. Tonight is an extraordinary night. I had an opportunity to meet the candidates earlier. They're excited to be here. We want to hear what they have to say. And so I want to thank the union leader and our media sponsors for being here tonight and helping us put on this wonderful event. I also want to take this opportunity to publicly thank Neil Levesque and his team for an outstanding job behind the scenes putting together all of the logistics for this event. So thank you, Neil. As most of you know, we are a college that was founded by Benedictine monks over 125 years ago. Part of our charism is hospitality, so we hope to be able to provide some of that hospitality tonight and over the next 6 months as this political process unfolds. The Institute of Politics is run on a day-to-day basis by our students. We have over 100 student ambassadors. Many of them greeted you this evening. They're working also behind the scenes. So if you have a chance later on and you run into one of our students, please thank them for their hard work and dedication to our New Hampshire political process. Finally, I would like to welcome you all on behalf of the monks, the faculty, the staff, and the students here at St. Anselm. And as Neil said, we have a wonderful opportunity to hear the candidates tonight. We are asking that you hold your applause later on, but this is an opportunity for you to meet the candidates. So please welcome the candidates. I would now invite two of our students to join us for the Pledge of Allegiance, Leah Stagnone and Brian O'Connor.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. As many of you know, we have hosted a series of events called Politics and Eggs. Many of the folks behind me have had an opportunity to meet our students and members of the community during those events. Those are opportunities for them to tell us their vision for the future and for us to ask questions. So tonight, we have an opportunity with everyone here to do the same. But it'll be moderated. We will have an opportunity to hear the presentations. The format, as will be described, will allow them a chance to talk about their platform, but then they'll have an opportunity to come up again and give us a little bit more information and perhaps clarify some things that were said. So it's an interesting format. It's a forum. It's not a debate. We are very, very blessed to have everyone here tonight. We know it's a very busy week, and it may be a prelude to other things later in the week, but we know that this is important because as the first in the nation primary state, as Governor Sununu used to say, in Iowa they pick corn, in New Hampshire we pick presidents, this is an opportunity for our voters to hear from the candidates. And so we are just about ready to go live. When the cameras roll, we will be on C-SPAN and broadcast on many other networks, so we do ask that everyone please be quiet during the presentations and keep their cell phones off. So, with no further ado, I leave you the candidates. Thank you.
From the Dana Center on the campus of beautiful St. Anselm College in Manchester, New Hampshire, and welcome to the 2016 Voters First Republican Presidential Forum. Tonight's forum is co-sponsored by the New Hampshire Union Leader, the Post and Courier, the Gazette, KCRG-TV, WLTX-TV, iHeartRadio, and our broadcast partner, C-SPAN. We would like to take a moment to thank our local sponsors, No Labels, Americans for Prosperity, Eversource, Eastern Bank, the Live Free or Die Alliance, and of course, our host, St. Anselm College. You will hear from 14 of the Republican candidates for President of the United States this evening. With us tonight are Governor Jeb Bush, Dr. Ben Carson, Governor Chris Christie, Carly Fiorina, Senator Lindsey Graham, Governor Bobby Jindal, Governor John Kasich, Governor George Pataki, Governor Rick Perry, Senator Rick Santorum, and Governor Scott Walker. With us via satellite from Washington, D.C. are Senator Ted Cruz, Senator Rand Paul, and Senator Marco Rubio. Please welcome our moderator for tonight's forum, Jack Heath, host of New Hampshire Today on iHeartRadio.
Good evening and thank you, candidates and audience. The Voters First Forum was the result of news media here in New Hampshire, Iowa, and South Carolina, all with the belief that voters in our three states and the rest of America deserve to hear from all of these candidates here tonight at the same time answering their questions. Our time will be tight this evening, and we want to hear from everyone. The order of speakers was drawn just moments ago randomly, and we've asked the candidates to skip their normal intros so we can get right to it. More questions, more answers for you, our voters. Let's meet our first candidate.
Governor Rick Perry served as the 47th governor of the state of Texas from 2000 to 2015.
Governor, thanks so much. We received thousands of responses from voters in our three states and around the country, but our three states focusing here tonight. We asked them what was most important to them, the number one issues facing voters here in New Hampshire, Iowa, and South Carolina. Topping the list, immigration and the economy. Governor, what would your administration's policy be toward illegal immigrants already in the U.S.?
Well, the real issue for us in this country today is what's happening all across our great land, and that is the cost that illegal immigration is having on this state. And until we get that border secure, it's not going to stop. It's like a serious wound. You want to staunch the flow, and that's not what's happening in this country now. For 30 years, we've heard people talk about, well, if we'll deal with this immigration, this illegal immigration issue, if we'll reform it, then we'll secure the border. And now we're in plus 30 years of that. The American people don't trust Washington, D.C. to deal with this issue of immigration reform until we secure the border. And I know a little something about securing the border. As a matter of fact, last summer I looked in the president's eye when he came to Dallas, Texas, and I said, Mr. President, if you don't secure the border, Texas will. And that's exactly what we did. We sent our Department of Public Safety, our Texas Rangers, our Parks and Wildlife Wardens, putting them literally in the river. And we also deployed our Texas National Guard. And because of that effort, we saw a 74% decrease in the number of apprehensions that were occurring in that part of the border. You can secure the border. It takes boots on the ground. It takes the security fencing in the metropolitan areas, and you have aviation assets. And I'm talking about from Tijuana to El Paso to Brownsville, flying 24/7, looking down with the technology to be able to see what's going on and identifying where there's activities that are obviously illegal or suspicious, and fast response team. That's what you have to do. I know how to secure that border. If you elect me President of the United States, I will promise you one thing. The will to secure that border will reside in the Oval Office.
Governor, I want to stick with immigration, as many of our voters are concerned. So much is made of illegal immigration. Until we get a handle on that, should we reduce the number of green cards granted legally each year to folks wanting to get into this country through the legal process? Should we cut down that number, and what should that number be each year?
Well, I think we need to be smart about our immigration, and the agency that we have today can't even keep up with people that come into the country. When you give a visa and they overstay it and we don't know where they are, I mean, Bobby, we know that they can find a package halfway around the world with UPS, and we can't keep up with the people that have overstayed their visas. I mean, for crying out loud, that agency is broken. You need to fix that agency of government that deals with these individuals that are coming in here. Be thoughtful about what is the workforce that we need. Allow the people in this country that we need in this country, and those that have overstayed their visas, you go find them, you pick them up, and you send them back wherever they're from.
But should we reduce the number temporarily of legal?
I don't know whether we need to reduce the number or not until we're able to find out, you know, who these people are that are in the country illegally. That's the real challenge, and if we get that taken care of first, then we can make a smart decision about whether or not we do or we don't need to have more visas being handed out.
George Will recently said on my radio show, the biggest problem facing the next president is an economy with a 2% GDP. If you're elected president, how can you make Washington and this country grow again at something greater than 2%?
Well, it's one of the reasons I'm a little bit more than just a passable expert on that, because the state of Texas created more jobs than anybody in this room over the course of the time that I was the governor. One third of all the jobs that were created in America occurred while I was the governor of the state of Texas. And we did it by having smart policies in place, tax policies that let you keep more of what you work for, a regulatory climate that is fair and predictable, legal system that didn't allow for oversuing, and public school policies that basically were accountable, that said to these businesses, you're going to find a skilled workforce in that state. And the way you do that in America is inextricably intertwined to our energy policy, a North American energy policy. I will suggest to you, Canada, the United States, Mexico has more known resources than of Russia and Saudi Arabia. Drive down the electric cost. Put those regulations into place that drive the income tax down, and you can create a renaissance in manufacturing like we've never seen.
Thank you. We have to respect time. Thank you, Governor Perry. Thank you.
Jack, thank you.
Rick Santorum represented the state of Pennsylvania in the U.S. House of Representatives from 1991 to 1995 and the U.S. Senate from 1995 to 2007.
Senator, should the federal government subsidize any economic sector, and if so, which ones?
I don't think we should be subsidizing, but we have to make sure that our economic sectors are competitive. One of the things I announced for president on the factory floor in western Pennsylvania talking about if we're going to restore the great center of America, we've got to get Americans back to work who haven't been working, haven't been rising. You saw just this past quarter, 0.2% wage growth. And if you look at where that the wage growth has really stagnated, it's the 74% of Americans between the age of 25 and 65 who don't have a college degree, who don't have manufacturing jobs to go to anymore. We had 20 million manufacturing jobs when Ronald Reagan was president. We're down to 11 million. If you look at that line, it's going straight down. If we don't allow our country to be competitive with the rest of the world, we're going to continue to see that decline, and there really is no hope for the folks who are struggling the most. That's why I put our campaign square on. We are going to make manufacturing competitive. We're going to put out a flat tax that'll have a transition period for manufacturing. We'll start out at a zero rate. We'll go back to everybody else's rate. But we want to incentivize that money to come into this country. We want to have repatriation to cut it to 5%, again, to bring that money here so we can invest in capital equipment, expensing instead of depreciation, again, to incentivize manufacturing.
Flat tax for individuals?
For everybody.
What percentage?
20%.
Rand Paul's proposed 14.5%.
Well, yeah, he also has a VAT tax, but I don't. I have a income tax, a corporate tax, all 20%.
Speaking of the economy, in New Hampshire, if someone maxes out on public assistance, experts tell me that's about $14 an hour, someone, if they max out on public assistance, and they may well need that. Massachusetts, south of the border, maybe $20. How do you incentivize Americans who are on public assistance to go back to work?
Well, you're talking the guy who led the welfare reform charge. I drafted the bill when I was in the House. 1996, I managed the bill on the floor of the Senate. We wanted to do two things in welfare, and we worked with the governors to get that done. We put time limits, and we put a work requirement. We did a great job. We eliminated the only federal entitlement program that's ever been eliminated. We did that. I did that. I was the leader of that. And we should have done it for SNAP. We should have done it for the other means-tested entitlement programs. We didn't. Next door here, Governor LePage has done that and seen a dramatic result of that, a reduction in benefits. But it has to be a 1-2 punch. We've got to create jobs. We've got to create jobs for these folks who want to work but just don't have good enough paying jobs with benefits to motivate them to get off of these welfare programs. So it's a combination of manufacturing and putting time limits and work requirements on welfare.
Do you believe this president and this administration truly want real border security?
I don't think this administration is serious about border security or serious about protecting working men and women. In the last 20 years, 35 million people have come into this country legally and illegally. Now, that can be a good thing or a bad thing, but the reality is wages for those workers I've been talking about have been flatlined for 20 years. We have never seen such decrepit wage growth, and who are the 90% of the people who are coming in legally and illegally? Almost all unskilled workers. To compete against our hardworking men and women who want a chance to succeed, but we're not giving it to them. I'm the only person in this race that has called for not just securing the border, following up on the visas, imposing E-Verify, but calling for a 25% reduction in the unskilled labor that's coming into this country. It is a serious problem. Everyone else is dancing around it. I'm going to stand for the American worker.
Briefly, Senator, how should we deal with employers who hire illegal immigrants or aliens?
E-Verify has to be universal, and employees, both current and future employees, have to comply with it.
You run before. You're glad you made the decision to do it again?
It's been a tremendous opportunity the last time around. This time around, it's actually better because last time everybody was trying to say we were more conservative than Mitt Romney. This time you're actually talking about issues and how we're going to help this country, and that's a good thing.
Thank you, Senator.
Thanks.
Governor John Kasich has served as governor of Ohio since 2011.
Governor, what would you do with the so-called sanctuary cities? In San Francisco, we saw that god-awful murder of that beautiful young mother by an illegal immigrant with a criminal.
Well, I think they're going to be eliminated, Jack. I mean, this is a Republican and Democrat agreement there. In terms of immigration, I mean, obviously the border needs to be secured. There needs to be an expanded guest worker program so people can move in and out and support their family, but do it in a legal way. With the 12 million, we need to find out who they are. If they're law-abiding, God-fearing folks, they're going to have to pay a penalty towards legalization, and they'll have to wait. And, you know, I think it's border, it's a reasonable guest worker program, and the ones who are the 12 million, if they violate the law, they're going to have to be deported or put in prison. And I think at the same time, we clearly need to make sure that we can protect who gets in and out of this country. And once we put something into effect like that, Anybody who comes in has got to be sent home. No one should be confused about it.
Are you a fan of NAFTA? Has it been a net gain for the U.S.?
You know, my problem with NAFTA is real simple, and that is if the American worker doesn't get protected, and here's what I mean by that. I have a friend that runs a steel company. He says that these foreign countries are dumping product in this country, destroying people's jobs. It takes us like 2 years to find out if they're cheating. You can't wait 2 years. Somebody's family's being destroyed, their jobs are being destroyed, it's pulling down communities. So, Jack, we need an expedited process. I'm basically a free trader, but I'm a fair trader. And if it makes sense, we'll go forward with it, but we've got to make sure that we have a mechanism in place to make sure that when people cheat, that we call them on it and we take action. You asked a question about the economy, if I could just speak on that for a second. You know, I was chairman of the budget committee when we balanced the federal budget. I was one of the chief architects, and our economy took off. You remember that in the late 90s and in the early 2000s, we were growing. Why? We cut taxes, we balanced budgets, it made sense. I became governor of Ohio. We were $8 billion in the hole. We cut taxes, we balanced budgets. We're now $2 billion in the black. We're up 350,000 jobs. Cutting taxes, balancing budgets is what works to drive economic growth.
Your answer on your own there got to a question that Tim in Hollis, New Hampshire, has asked, and that is balancing the budget. To paraphrase his question, he and his wife have to live with a budget in the household, and they don't understand why Washington is the antithesis and doesn't live with a budget. What faith can you give to them that if you're elected president, the budget was balanced once before, but now it hasn't happened? How is Washington going to live with the same fiscal discipline that households here in New Hampshire and apartments and condominiums have to live with every week between groceries and heating and kids and budget and mortgage? How do we get Washington to live within its means?
Well, Jack, first of all, we need a balanced budget amendment to the Constitution, which I have been pushing since I was a very young man and been traveling the country trying to get that done, number one. Number two, look, it's about record and accomplishment. I was there. I spent 10 years of my life balancing the budget, not because of numbers, but because of values. Just the values, when people have to balance their budgets, so should the government. And in addition to that, we don't have the right to live high on the hog and put the bills on our children. That is immoral. So I spent 10 years working at it. Frankly, we got it balanced with Senator Domenici and the Clinton administration. We got it done, and we can do it. We can do it again. It is politically challenging, but frankly, the effort to get there is not that complicated. I've written only about 16 budgets in my lifetime, including the one that took Ohio from $8 billion in the hole to $2 billion in the black. These things can be done, but they don't necessarily have to be done by killing programs or chopping programs. You make them work better. So that couple, I'm president of the United States. My number one priority is to get us on a roadmap to a balanced federal budget to create jobs in America.
Thank you, Governor.
Thank you.
Senator Lindsey Graham was elected to the U.S. House in 1994 and has served as a U.S. Senator since 2002.
Senator, good evening. How do we maintain free trade that is fair trade? And what nations specifically are cheating us?
Well, China is cheating. They manipulate their currency to create a discount for products made in China, and we don't do a damn thing about it. They're building islands over resource-rich territory owned by others because they can. They cyber attack us, steal our intellectual property, and nobody pushes back. If I'm president, we're going to push back against China. Here's my foreign policy, my trade policy: a clenched fist and an open hand. You choose.
Speaking of China, certain nations have been accused of stealing and breaking into our databases in the government and business. If it's President Graham and you catch a country doing that, how can we stop it? And what do you do?
Well, one, you hit back. You make them pay a price. Most people do things they can get away with until it costs too much. In China, China cheats, they steal, but it's just not China. We've been walked all over. I'm tired of it. I want a clenched fist and an open hand. To Mr. Putin, if I'm president of the United States, you're going to have a different person to deal with. Why is he in the Ukraine today? Because when Obama drew a red line against Assad and didn't do anything about it, China thought, hey, this is a weak guy, let's grab all we can grab. In the Ukraine, he took what he wanted. The Iranians, they don't think that Obama's going to use military force at all. And how could you get John Kerry away from the negotiating table with a crowbar? So at the end of the day, our foreign policy is failing. We're not respected around the world. There are more terrorist organizations with more capability to strike our homeland than any time since 9/11. And to radical Islam, here's my policy: whatever it takes, as long as it takes to defeat you.
You mentioned Vladimir Putin in the Ukraine. Should we be arming troops?
We should do four things. arm the Ukrainians so they can fight for their own freedom. We signed an agreement with Ukraine in the 90s. If you'll give up your 2,400 nuclear weapons, excuse me, we'll guarantee your sovereignty. Who would do that in the future? Arm the Ukrainians so they can fight for their freedom. Take every bit of natural gas we can find in America in an environmentally sound way that we don't use and export it to Europe and undercut Putin's monopoly. Rebuild NATO after we rebuild our own military. Everybody talks about balancing the budget and spending money. We're on the road to becoming Greece. If you don't do what Judge Gregg says and fix the debt, reform Medicare and Social Security, all the money is going to go to pay those bills. When I was 21, my mom died. When I was 22, my dad died. We lived in the back of a liquor store. I'm 60 years old. Somebody in this country needs to do what Ronald Reagan and Dip O'Neill did. Get us together. You know, I could give up some Social Security benefits today because I'm going to have a military retirement, a congressional retirement, a 401k plan. I would take less knowing that people need it more than I do. When I was 22, I needed every penny. I want to be president. To restore a great nation, to put radical Islam in a box and to get us off the road to Greece. And that means we got to work together and do the big things, the hard things.
Americans and here in New Hampshire are worried about lone wolf terrorists. We're worried about ISIS. We're worried about ISIS.
Yeah.
But the war tomorrow may already be here today. We have 500 satellites out there in space that control ATMs, GPS. If someone took out one of those satellites and caused chaos here in a city or the heartland, As President Graham, would you respond? Is that an act of war or not?
I would respond. To me, that'd be an act of war. Here's the problem. As the threats of this country grow, we're disarming ourselves. I've never seen more threats, particularly in the cyber arena. So what is our response? To cut the military budget to have the smallest army since 1940, the smallest navy since 1915, to neuter the FBI, the CIA, and the NSA at a time we need them the most. The only way we're going to prevent an attack on this country is hit them before they come here. And as to Hillary Clinton, the last person in the world you want to send into the arena with the Russians is Hillary Clinton. As to the Clintons, I've been dealing with this crowd for 20 years. I'm fluent in Clinton speak. You want me to translate, Jack? When he says, Bill says, I didn't have sex with that woman, he did. When she says, I'll tell you about building the pipeline when I get to be president, means she won't. And when she tells us, trust me, you've got all the emails that you need, we haven't even scratched the surface. So I understand this crowd, and I can beat them, and if we can't beat them, it doesn't matter.
Thank you, Senator.
Governor Chris Christie has served as the governor of New Jersey since 2010.
Thank you, Governor. Let me start, and I want to get to some questions that hit home here in New Hampshire. But first, as president, should a president ever sanction the payment for the release of American citizen held captive by terrorists?
No, and absolutely should not. We can't do that. We can't negotiate with terrorists. I understand this. I was a United States attorney for 7 years in New Jersey, fought against terrorism, appointed right before September 11th. We just encourage those folks by doing that. We can't do it.
Governor, it may be the message. It may be that Republicans aren't great communicators like Democrats, but entitlement reform is a tough subject. We know that some of the most popular programs, Medicare, disability with Social Security, they're basically going insolvent or will be broke. They'll go under soon. To tell the Americans they have to give something up, a program they may like and not want to give up or see cut, is a tough message. How do you win an election for president and tell the truth on entitlement reform?
First off, you have to have a concrete plan. You can't just speak in generalities and vague generalities to folks. 71% of federal spending right now is between entitlements and debt service. When the American people hear that, they understand that what we're doing is we're mortgaging away not only our children's future, but also killing those programs. So we need to tell them the truth. We need to tell them that we're living now much longer and much better quality of life. That's a blessing. So we need to increase the retirement age over a period of time. I've said 2 years over the next 25 years. We need to tell them that for those who are most fortunate, and I just heard Lindsay say this, you know, we need to say to those folks, if you've done very well in this country, then we need you to not take a Social Security check. Those are things that Americans are willing to hear. The problem is us. We underestimate the American people. They've always risen to challenges, especially challenges that promise them a better future for their children and grandchildren. It's not the American people who are failing the entitlement system. It's the leaders of our country who are failing the American people by not telling them the truth.
Governor, I want to ask you quickly, two groups very important to me. One is veterans in New Hampshire. We have one of the highest populations per capita of veterans in America. We do not have a full-time VA hospital. Should every state have a full-time VA hospital?
No, what should happen, in my view, is that every veteran should be kept the promise that was given to them, which is they should be able to take their veterans card and go to any health care provider in any hospital in America and get treatment when they ask for it. They shouldn't have to wait on a VA line. If they want to go to a VA hospital, that's great, good for them. But if they want to go someplace else, we should keep that promise to our veterans. And we're not keeping that promise right now because of the incompetence of this administration. So let's get the VA to do what they need to do, which is to provide health care to our folks through the card to any health care provider, and let the American public step up to the plate like we want to honor our veterans by giving them the health care that they've been promised.
The governor of New Hampshire, the mayor of the state's largest city, have called the heroin crisis now one of the biggest crises facing New Hampshire here. One of the folks working here tonight asked me pretty passionately if I would ask one of you this tonight. Her daughter recently passed away to a heroin overdose. She's now trying to do some good with it. She wants to know why there's not rehabilitation in prison, why there's not more help for these addicts versus just arresting them when they have to turn to prostitution or breaking into a family's member home or car just to get more money to support their habit. Why are we falling down on the heroin crisis?
Listen, there should be, and there is in New Jersey. We're the first state in the country to say for first-time nonviolent drug offenders, no more prison. They're going to mandatory inpatient drug treatment because this is a disease, and the war on drugs has been a failure. Well-intentioned, but a failure. We're looking at this as a moral failing by people. Everyone makes mistakes. Everyone in this audience has made a mistake. There but for the grace of God go I for those people who have been stricken with the disease of drug and alcohol addiction. And what we need to do is to reach out as a public and embrace those people and say, if you're not a violent offender, if you're not dealing drugs to our children, then we need to get you treatment rather than prison. And the fact is that this can happen to anyone. People think that this is somehow guided by socioeconomic or educational standards. It's not. Anyone can have this happen to them. And what we need is to have a country, and we need to have a president who's going to stand up and say, this is a disease, and we need to fix it.
Thank you, Governor.
Dr. Ben Carson attended Yale University and received his MD from the University of Michigan Medical School.
Dr. Carson, so much, and you've been one of the folks who've talked a lot early on about some of the faults with the Affordable Care Act, or so-called Obamacare. And I call it that because the president said we can refer to it as Obamacare.
Sure.
What the Republicans have criticized, what do you replace it with? So if it's repealed, what do you replace it with? Because we have problems in the health and in the insurance and healthcare system.
Sure.
What do you replace it with?
Well, there's no question that it needs to be replaced before you repeal it, because you don't want to pull the safety net out from underneath people. And the reason that I don't like Obamacare, first of all, not so much because it doesn't work and not so much because it's unaffordable, but really because it flies in the face of what we are as a nation that is up for and by the people, with the government there to facilitate life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Obamacare comes along with the government saying, we don't care what you, the people, think. We're shoving this down your throat, and if you don't like it, too bad. That's completely antithetical to the principles of the founding of this country. So I would replace it with something that really puts the power back in the hands of consumers and healthcare providers. Health savings accounts available from the day you're born until the day you die. You can pass it on when you die. We pay for it with the same dollars that we use for traditional health care. And you give people flexibility, the ability to actually move money within their family. You're $500 short, your wife can give it to you out of hers, or your cousin, or your uncle. It gives you enormous flexibility to cover almost anything. And then your catastrophic health care costs a lot less, because virtually nothing is coming out of it except for catastrophic health care. It's like a homeowner's policy with a big deductible versus a homeowner's policy where you want every single thing covered. Now, that works very well for the majority of people, not so well for the indigent. And you know, how do we take care of the indigent now? Medicaid. Annual Medicaid budget, $400 to $500 billion. How many people participate? A quarter of the population, about 80 million people. 80 million into 400 billion goes 5,000 times, $5,000 each man, woman, and child in America. What could you buy with that? A concierge practice. Most of those cost between $2,000 and $3,000 a year. Still have a couple thousand left over for your catastrophic insurance. I'm not advocating we do that. I'm saying that's how much money there is. And think about what happens. First of all, Washington would say you can't give health savings accounts to the indigent because they're too stupid and they wouldn't be able to manage them. They think everybody's like them. But the fact that it's not true, and in fact, you know, they said that about food stamps, and people learn how to manage food stamps. And they would learn this too. Mr. Jones, who has that diabetic foot ulcer, quickly learns not to go to the emergency room, spend five times more. He would go to the clinic, same treatment, but instead of just sending him out, they say, now let's get your diabetes under control so you're not back here in 3 weeks with another problem. He's learning personal responsibility, and we're doing things that teach that rather than dependency.
A quick one for you. Some of our participants tonight are in the Senate because they had a vote tonight. One of the measures, Planned Parenthood. Should taxpayers fund Planned Parenthood?
Absolutely, they should not fund Planned Parenthood. You know, these recent videos show the atrocity of that and the level of depravity that we have sunk into as a nation. And we simply have to stop that. If people want to do it, let them take money out of their pocket. Let them find other depraved individuals to help them.
We have another doctor in the audience. There may be more, Dr. Carson, but Dr. Oscar Green of Londonderry submitted this question. When elected president, what is your game plan to reform the tax code?
Well, you know, I base mine on who I believe is the fairest individual in the universe. That would be God. And he said, I want a tithe. He didn't say if your crops fail, no tithe. And if you have a bumper crop, triple tithe. So there must be something inherently fair about proportionality, and that's what I would do. It would have to be somewhere between 10 and 15% initially, and there'd be no deductions and no loopholes.
We'll come back on your second round. Thank you, Dr. Carson.
Thank you.
Governor Jeb Bush served as the 43rd governor of the state of Florida from 1999 to 2007.
Governor, is America doing enough now to prevent another major terrorist attack on U.S. soil? And what security steps are we failing to take?
Well, I think we've let our guard down a little bit. It's typical. It happens when you have an attack on our country, like happened in 9/11. We united. We responded. We created, I think, a security apparatus that kept us safe. And over time now, concerns about civil liberties and other things have come into the forefront. And I think we need to reinvigorate this. I think Senator Graham is absolutely right. This is a war against Western civilization. These are barbarians. As ISIS stays totally in a caliphate, literally the size of Indiana, in two countries, a day apparently, to recruit people here in our own country. And so we have a security threat that is real, and that we need to do what we should be doing, which is a strategy to take them out. And protecting the homeland is the first duty of the President of the United States.
Governor, President Obama recently referred to ISIS as the JV team.
He did.
I think arguably now we'd all agree they've graduated to a varsity threat. What would your plan be to defeat them? And if your generals told you that in a month or so, ground and air troops and special forces in Syria could significantly cut down ISIS strongholds, would you give the order?
I would take the advice of the military very seriously. We need a strategy first. This president has for two times has admitted that we don't have a strategy as it relates to ISIS. It's pretty amazing. I think we need special forces. The idea of boots on the ground, I'm not sure that's necessary, but special forces, embedding our troops and our trainers with the Syrian Free Army, training them at a much faster rate. We've spent $500 million to have 60 people ready to go. I mean, this is absurd. If this is a serious effort, then we need to treat it seriously. And so engaging in the world, creating alliances with our traditional Arab nations that see this threat directly, supporting it with air power and military power, and creating a strategy and sticking with it. The final thing I'd say is that there needs to be a political element of this as well. If the United States isn't trusted because no one has a sense that we're going to be around, then it's really hard to engage with the Turks, the Jordanians, the Emiratis, the Saudis. They're not going to make the commitment.
Governor, you said to me behind stage when we met that you started today in California.
Yeah.
It's a big country, hard job running for president. You've been out of office for quite a while. And even your colleague, Senator Rubio, speaks highly of your time as Florida governor. What compelled you to run?
I think we can grow our economy at 4% instead of this anemic 2%.
You think we can get to 4%
absolutely.
GDP? Oh,
absolutely. Yeah, and the fact that Paul Krugman disagrees with me warms my heart. The fact is we can grow at that rate. It will require fixing a few really big, complex things. the tax code, how we regulate, embracing the energy revolution with a North American strategy that will allow for high-wage jobs to be created in our own country, and fixing entitlements, along with moving from a broken legal immigration system to an economic driver. All those things could allow us to grow at a faster rate. It allows us to solve our entitlement challenges and many other things. And in order to grow at that rate, we also need a secure world. I think I have the leadership skills based on my record to do that. We cut taxes totaling $19 billion, reduced the state government workforce by 13,000, 11%. We were one of two states to go to AAA bond rating during my time. I left as governor with a $9 billion reserve for a rainy day for the next guy, and we created 1.3 million jobs during my time. Small businesses, more jobs, more small businesses were created in Florida during those 8 years.
Real quickly, on legal immigration, does the illegal immigration problem a crisis, should that affect the number of folks we let in legally?
I think we need to narrow the number of people coming by family petitioning.
So you'd cut it down some?
I would it down to spouse and minor children instead of adult siblings and adult parents.
We'll come back to it in the next round. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Carly Fiorina, the former CEO of Hewlett-Packard, was the first woman to lead a Fortune 50 business.
What is the, it's kind of a personal but a professional question. You've been in both, well, you've run for office, but you were top 50 CEO. I've had you on my show. You've talked a lot about your business background, humble start. But one of our people who submitted this wants to know, what's the least popular action you've taken as a leader, and what did you learn from it?
Well, if I may just start by saying thank you, St. Anselm's, for hosting this, and thank you, Joe McQuaid, as well, for reminding the political class that we don't have a national primary and managing to get all of the candidates here to the first in the nation primary state. Thank you for doing that. I think one of the most difficult decisions you have as a leader is to challenge the status quo, whatever the status quo is. The status quo in any system, in a business, in a bureaucracy, and especially in Washington, D.C., is powerful because people who have benefited from the status quo want to preserve the status quo. And so when you challenge the status quo, when you say, you know what, this problem has been festering for too long and we're going to finally fix it, or these folks have been in charge for too long, we've been talking about this for too long, we're going to fix it. The truth is, 80% of the American people now think we have a professional political class that is like in the status quo, and we have festering problems. Our budget gets bigger and bigger every year for 40 years. We've been talking a lot today about illegal immigration. How long have we been talking about the border being insecure? 30 years. How long have we known it was insecure? 30 years. How long has it been insecure? 30 years. We talk a lot at election time, but somehow we never solve these festering problems. It's because the status quo is in charge. Leaders challenge the status quo.
Least popular action you took, though, as a leader?
I think the least popular actions are when you have to say to people, we can't afford to do this anymore. And Lord knows we need to do that in Washington, D.C.
Can you win with that message?
Of course. People understand. Honestly, our government has gotten bigger and bigger every year for almost 50 years. You have to invest in those things that are priority, securing the border, helping people who truly need help, and you need to quit spending money where you're wasting money. And we are wasting hundreds upon hundreds of millions of dollars every year. And by the way, we know where it is, because there are reports that come out every year. They land like a thud on Congress's desks, and literally nothing happens.
Former First Lady Hillary Clinton, I've noticed you've been a very strong and steady critic of Hillary Clinton. She's going to be testifying, I believe, coming up in a few months on Benghazi, maybe the emails. Do you think those are political inconveniences for the former First Lady, or are there bigger issues that the American people need to know about, and are there any potential illegal worries that you have on the email server or anything else?
I think Hillary Clinton thinks they are political inconveniences. That's what she gives off, but they are far more than that. She lied about Benghazi. They knew it was a purposeful terrorist attack on the anniversary of 9/11. She went to the American people and talked some fiction about a videotape. She stood over the bodies of the fallen. She has as well lied about her servers and the kinds of information she had on her server and why she kept everything on a single device. These go to the core of her character. But here's the thing. in order to beat Hillary Clinton or whoever their nominee turns out to be, we have to have a nominee on our side who is going to throw every punch, because this is a fight. It's a fight for the future of this nation. It's a fight for the character of this nation. And unfortunately, we know that sometimes the right questions don't get asked in a presidential debate.
Should Planned Parenthood receive federal taxpayer funding?
Absolutely not. This is about the character, the moral character of our nation. It's not about whether you're pro-choice or pro-life. Just as taking care of people who need our care is part of the moral fiber of our nation as well.
Thank you. Look forward to the next round. Thank you.
Governor Bobby Jindal was elected to U.S. House of Representatives in 2004 and has served as governor of Louisiana since 2007.
Governor Jindal, if you are the next American president, I think most people would agree, you'd be coming into a very divided America on race relations, income relations, a lot of talk about who has how much and how much money and who doesn't and what you do about that. How can you unify this country?
Jack, I'm so tired of this president and the left trying to divide us. You're exactly right. They try to divide us by gender, by race, by income, by geography. Look, we're all Americans. We're not hyphenated Americans. We're not African Americans or Asian Americans or rich Americans or poor Americans. We're all Americans. This president's done an awful job. The left likes us to see ourselves as victims. It benefits them politically. As president, I'm going to unify the American people and say, look, we all benefit when we grow the economy. We all benefit when we shrink the size of the federal government. This president's trying to turn the American dream into the European nightmare. He's trying to make us more dependent on government. Give Bernie Sanders credit. At least he's honest enough to call himself a socialist. Hillary Clinton, President Obama, they're no better. They're just not honest enough to call themselves socialists. So as president, I'll unite the American people. No more hyphenated Americans, no more divisions.
I want to come back to balancing budget, making Washington work for us again. I think there's this feeling that almost everyone, regardless of their political affiliation, would agree that Washington is not working for America. In fact, it may be working against us. You have a good story to tell. We have a few other governors here have a good story to tell, balancing the budgets, cutting the deficit, growing jobs. How do we believe that you can actually go to Washington if elected and change the culture of Washington to actually balancing budgets and making the American people feel good about our government again?
Jack, that's a great question. Two things. One, we've got a lot of talkers. We need to do it. So we've cut the size of our budget in Louisiana 26%. We've cut over 30,000 fewer state bureaucrats than the day I took office. I had Democratic majorities in the House and the Senate my first term. 8 credit upgrades, top 10 state for private sector job creation. In D.C., even the Republicans talk about simply slowing the growth of federal spending. That's not enough. We've got a bunch of math deniers in D.C. in both parties. We do need to shrink the size of the federal government. This election is very simple. Do you measure prosperity in the government sector or the real world? Hillary Clinton measures it in the government sector. We measure it in the real world. Secondly, it is also important that we get rid of this permanent political class in D.C. We absolutely need term limits. We have these politicians that go and live there and becomes a career. They become highly paid lobbyists. Not only do we need term limits, we need to stop them from being lobbyists, pay them a per diem. Jack, I'd pay them every day they stay outside of D.C. rather than every day they go to D.C. Make them live under the same rules they passed for the rest of us. They all loved Obamacare until their exemption was taken away. Then they didn't like it so much.
New Hampshire recently, the governor and the adjutant general of the National Guard decided against arming recruiters and our National Guard or troops here domestically, as when they're abroad, as you know, they can carry a sidearm and protect themselves in an embassy or a center. Should we be arming troops here in New Hampshire and in your state of Louisiana and around the country at these bases and recruiting centers, given the lone wolf terror threat?
Absolutely. I signed that executive order already in Louisiana, allowing our adjutant general to arm our National Guardsmen. Our commander-in-chief, our president, needs to do the same for our active military. We shouldn't have these gun-free zones. The president went to the Pentagon and said, we're not going to beat ISIS with guns. He said it's a generational conflict. We have to change their hearts and minds. Jack, I'm glad that that police officer in Texas had a gun in Garland, Texas. If General Patton Eisenhower had said World War II was going to be a propaganda war, the French would be speaking German. Absolutely, let's arm our military.
Briefly, I'd like to take the president at his word with the Iranian deal that it's the only way to stop Iran from getting a bomb. Do you agree or disagree, and what would your plan or deal with Iran be?
absolutely disagree. This is a bad deal. He has declared war on trans fats and a ceasefire with the largest state-sanctioned sponsor of terrorism. Look, a good deal would say anytime, anywhere inspections, would say no centrifuges, no enriched uranium, would say they have to cut off ties to Hamas, Hezbollah, and terrorist groups. They have to recognize Israel's right to exist. They have to free those American prisoners. We will only, no plutonium pathway, we will only gradually lift sanctions, not immediately. Syria loves it. Israel hates the deal. That tells you all you need to know when our friends hate it and our enemies love it.
Thank you, Governor.
Governor Scott Walker has served as the 45th governor of the state of Wisconsin since 2011.
Governor, thanks for being with us. Is climate change related to human activity, and what steps, if any, should America be taking to address climate change? And I'd like you to comment to the president's proposal today, I believe. I went a little bit busy today, to cut carbon emissions 25%. Is that realistic?
Well, first off, it's not the clean power plan, it's the costly power plan. It would be like a buzzsaw to the nation's economy. The states like mine and many of the other governors here would be devastated by that. You know, I'm an Eagle Scout. We were taught a long time ago, your campsite should be cleaner when you leave than when you find it. So I want to balance a sustainable environment with a sustainable economy. But the two have to go hand in hand. I want clean air, clean land, clean water, but I want an economy that my children and grandchildren someday can grow in as well. And so the two have to go hand in hand. This proposal today, like I said, is a buzzsaw to the nation's economy, and we need a leader in the White House who's going to actually recognize that balance.
It wasn't long ago when Congress looked at cutting the budget. I think they balked, and sequestration came about. What, if you were elected president, how could you lead and work with Congress, both sides of the aisle, to really cut spending and try to be specific on some areas in that budget that you think could and need to be cut?
Well, I'm all for a balanced budget. I inherited a $3.6 billion budget deficit. We fixed it. In fact, we fixed it and still reduced taxes by some $2 billion. We reduced them on individuals, cut rates, reduced one of the brackets, actually did it on job creators and farmers and manufacturers and others out there. And then we actually lowered property taxes. In fact, property taxes in my state are lower today than they were 4 years ago. So I know how to balance a budget. It's something I've done in the past. I think it's a combination of things. It can't just be through cuts and austerity. It's got to be through growth and reform. By growth, we laid out a multi-pronged plan to once and for all repeal Obamacare and put patients and families back in charge of their health care, to rein in the sort of things we just talked about, the out-of-control regulations from the federal government that are like a wet blanket on the nation's economy, to put in place an all-of-the-above energy policy that allows us to use the abundance what God has given us here, to make sure that everyone gets the education and skills they need to succeed, and then to reform and lower the tax rates in this country. I think that'll help growth. And then on the other side, on specifics, on reductions, I think a big part of reform is taking major portions of the federal government, being it Medicaid, transportation, education, natural resources, and others, and take them from Washington, send them back to states. Governors of both parties are much better at being more effective, more efficient, and more accountable in managing those programs.
Your path in Wisconsin as governor, you've survived a recall. You've got a good story like some of these other governors on balancing the budget. I think you have a surplus. How much now?
We went from $3.6 billion in all. We started with $1 billion. We used it to cut taxes by about $500 million. And we got another budget that will end up over the next two periods with a cash balance again. In fact, our rainy day fund's 165 times bigger than we first took office.
But in the process, you've nationally been known as someone who took on the unions. Mm-hmm. Are you anti-union or anti-worker?
No, I'm pro-worker and pro-taxpayer. We gave workers the freedom to choose. We made Wisconsin a right-to-work state. We gave workers the freedom to choose whether they want to be in a labor union or not. Many chose to keep that money that they used to pay for union dues to pay for their kids' college education or other things on behalf of their family. We're pro-taxpayer. Before, you know, all the power was concentrated in the hands of the elite union bosses, we instead redistributed that back to the hardworking taxpayers and the people they duly elect. So, for example, in our schools, we no longer have seniority or tenure. We can hire and fire based on merit. We can pay based on performance. That means we can put the best and the brightest in our classrooms. And 4 years later, graduation rates are up, third grade reading scores are up, ACT scores are now second best in the country. If it can work in a blue state like Wisconsin, it wasn't too late for Wisconsin. It's not too late for America.
Biggest challenge since you've been governor that you feel you were successful on?
Well, without a doubt, taking on that initial challenge with the budget deficit and doing it in a way that really focused on reform and growth, not just on austerity. If I had just been about cuts across the board, I probably would have been recalled. But instead, I focused on reform and growth, and that made all the difference.
Thank you, Governor.
Thank you.
Governor George Pataki served as the 53rd governor of the state of New York from 1995 to 2006.
As you get seated, Governor, this question comes from the Live Free or Die Alliance here in New Hampshire. What federal government agencies do you think should be eliminated?
Well, let me start very briefly by saying we should get rid of Obamacare, we should get rid of Common Core, and we should reduce the size of the federal workforce by at least 15%. Now, people are going to say, how can you do that? I was governor in New York 3 terms. I had an overwhelmingly Democratic state legislature. I was able to get changes like that through. I reduced the size of the New York state workforce by over 15%. We reformed entitlements, cut the growth in Medicaid. We changed the welfare system. When I left, we had over 1 million fewer people on welfare than when I took office. So we have to shrink the size of the federal government. One program I'd repeal is Obamacare, and by the way, to do that, we're going to have to get Democratic votes. We haven't even been able to send repeal to the president for his veto. I will work to get Democrats to support our conservative policies. I did that in New York.
Do you believe that the Affordable Care Act can really, I mean, politically, honestly
Absolutely.
Speaking, be repealed?
Not only,
what entitlement program
can
been repealed?
Not only can it be repealed, I think it has to be repealed. It's just going to get worse and worse. Not only is it hurting health care for Americans from all across the economic spectrum, it is also one of the reasons our economy is not growing. I can't tell you the number of employers I know who said we're going to keep our workforce down below 50, so we're out from under Obamacare. There are millions and millions of Americans working 28 or 29 hours a week because Obamacare would kick in if they worked 30. We have to put in place an alternative. And what I would do is sit down with enough Democrats, as I did in New York, to have an alternative that allows us to repeal it and replace it with a system that actually empowers the patient.
One of our folks here in New Hampshire wants to know, what group do you think is treated most unfairly by the U.S. tax code?
The veterans. I think not just by the tax code, but, this is a country, and our freedom depends on those who put their lives on the line to defend it. And to have a health care system for our veterans that denies them service, where as many as one-third of those waiting in line for treatment have died before they even get there, and then an administration that lies about it is completely wrong. So we have to reform the health care system for our veterans. We also have to do more for their mental health. But on the tax code, the biggest single killer there is for manufacturing. I grew up in a small town, and I'm the only one, I think, who actually worked in a factory when I was going through college. My family all worked in a factory. They were great jobs. We have the highest tax on manufacturing in the world today. We have the worst regulatory climate for manufacturers today. We have to lower the tax burden. I would pass a law having our manufacturing rate the lowest in the world. That would allow our great workforce to compete and create jobs. And by the way, Jack, despite the bad federal policy on manufacturing, while I was governor, we were able to get over $20 billion in private sector investment in building computer chip factories in upstate New York. Great jobs. Grow the economy, allow the workers to have the opportunity to have a solid career, and shrink the federal government.
What should the U.S. corporate tax rate be? What number?
I think the federal tax rate, I think for manufacturing, I would say 12%, which is lower than the competitors. Our energy costs are coming down, maybe not here in New Hampshire, but in the rest of the country. We have the best workforce and work ethic in the world. We have entrepreneurs. We have risk takers. The federal government is the biggest single impediment. We can grow manufacturing jobs here.
Been asking the candidates tonight on Planned Parenthood, should taxpayers fund it?
No. The videos just point out quite clearly that Planned Parenthood has a horrific disregard for basic human life, and I think they should be defunded and the funds reprogrammed for other women's health care services. By the way, Jack, well...
Oh, okay, thanks, Governor. We'll get you on the next round. We'll get you on the next round. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you.
Now, I believe joining us from Washington are 3 senators who had to be at the Capitol this evening for an important vote. It was out of their control. They wanted to be here, but we're happy to have them joining us by satellite. And I believe we are joined by our senators. And we're just going to start with Senator Rand Paul. Senator, good evening. Running for president in 1952, General Dwight Eisenhower famously said, "I shall go to Korea." If you're elected president, Senator, name the first foreign spot nation you will travel to.
Well, first of all, thanks for letting us appear remotely. I've been leading the fight for the last 2 weeks to defund Obamacare, and I was lucky enough to get a vote on that this evening. As far as first country I will meet, or first country I will travel to, you know, I think it's important that we do engage with the world. So I think it's very important that even though China is sometimes our adversary, Russia is sometimes our adversary, that we do interact with these once great superpowers and emerging superpowers. And so I would say either China or Russia.
Senator, how would you lessen college debt for millions of Americans?
Well, I have a plan that would make it deductible. Right now, there are limitations. Certain families can't deduct it because of their income, and certain families are prescribed by the time. So I would say your interest and your principal ought to be deducted over your entire working career. Essentially, college is a working expense, and so I would let you deduct it as a working expense over and throughout your entire working career. And I think this makes more sense than the president who just says, hey, it's going to be free. There's no free lunch. You can't just offer free education. But I think tying it to work and making it deductible is a good idea.
Senator Paul, should an American citizen found to be fighting with ISIS have their U.S. citizenship revoked?
Yes, and in fact, you really don't have any rights if you're in the battlefield. If you're aiming a gun at one of our soldiers, it's not like you get due process. And some people confuse this because I fought long and hard and filibustered for over 13 hours to say that non-combatants do have rights and shouldn't be killed without due process. But those who are involved in combat really don't get due process and will be shot if they're fighting against America. But it is important to know that American citizens here do get due process. We do get the Bill of Rights. And the danger we've had in the past is when we've grouped people like Japanese Americans together and incarcerated them, or what we did to African Americans pre-civil rights days. So we do have to be very important that we individualize suspicion and that we not collect everyone's phone records all the time without suspicion. So I'm glad we've ended the president's illegal phone program, and I think this is a better protection of the Fourth Amendment and the right to privacy. And I am the one candidate who will do that. I'm the one candidate who has stood up to the president and say, no more, we're not going to let you collect our phone records indiscriminately with a generalized warrant.
Well, Senator, let me follow up then and ask you, what private information should the government collect from individuals to guarantee homeland security? Where do you draw the line?
Well, I think we should collect more information on terrorists, but less information on innocent individuals. We have a way now to get information. It's called the Fourth Amendment. You have to individualize suspicion. And actually, most of the times we've been attacked, we actually have had tips, and we just didn't follow through on them. The 19th hijacker, Massawi, we had information and we failed to get a warrant. It wasn't that a warrant was denied. The Boston bomber, we had information, we failed to pursue it. Same way with Fort Hood massacre, had information and failed to pursue it. I think we can catch terrorists if we get more information on terrorists, but there's no evidence. There's three bipartisan commissions that say, you know what, the information we're capturing indiscriminately on all Americans hadn't caught any terrorists and hasn't made us safer, but it has damaged our Bill of Rights and it has damaged our right to privacy.
Senator Paul, but are you concerned that it might take some time in a terrorist situation with ICE or police or federal agents to stop a bomb going off if you have to get that warrant?
There are always imminent circumstances in which things can happen. In someone screaming from a building, you don't stop to get a warrant. It's the same way with the bomb. So there have always been exigent circumstances. But for the most part, you do need to get a warrant. And the real question we've had is about collecting all Americans' phone records all the time. Is that a good idea, or is that a breach of our Fourth Amendment right to privacy? I think most of America agrees with me that the president went too far. This is a president who investigated Tea Party groups, has used the IRS to go after conservative groups. So I think it's really not a good idea to trust this president with our records. I'm glad that I stood up on principle and stood for 10 and a half hours on the Senate floor to say enough's enough. The president shouldn't be collecting all these records. We can catch terrorists, but do it in a targeted fashion and do more collection of information on terrorists, just less on innocent Americans.
Thank you, Senator. My next question is for a colleague on your left or right, Senator Ted Cruz. Arthur Schwartz here in Manchester is in the audience tonight. He wonders what your deal with Iran would look like.
Well, Jack, thank you very much. Thank you for allowing us to be here via satellite. We had to be here to vote to defund Planned Parenthood, and I hope very much that we see Republican leadership actually lead the fight to get it done and we stop funding Planned Parenthood. But let me answer the question you asked, because it's a very important one. I believe this Obama-Iranian nuclear deal is the single gravest national security threat facing America. It is a catastrophic deal. If this deal goes through, several things will happen. First of all, roughly $100 billion, over $100 billion, will flow into Iran. Iran is the world's leading state sponsor of terrorism. That money, in turn, billions of it, will go on to Hamas, to Hezbollah, to the Houthis. You know, it's very interesting. I pointed out a couple of weeks ago that if this deal goes through, that the Obama administration will become the world's leading global financier of radical Islamic terrorism. In response, just last week, President Obama attacked me from Africa for saying that. He said that rhetoric was overheated. Well, let me tell you, Jack, speaking the truth is not rhetoric. The truth is, if this administration, if President Obama and Hillary Clinton and John Kerry are responsible for sending billions of dollars to Iran, and that Iran goes, those billions go to jihadists who use that money to murder Americans, to murder Israelis, to murder Europeans, then the administration is responsible. Beyond that, this deal leaves four American hostages languishing in Iran. We've already seen one president in the 1970s who abandoned our hostages in Iran. We shouldn't see another. And this deal accelerates Iran acquiring nuclear weapons. What should we do? I've already introduced legislation in the Senate that would reimpose sanctions, that would strengthen them, and that would lay out a clear path, a sensible path for Iran to lift sanctions, that they would disassemble all 19,000 centrifuges, they would hand over their enriched uranium, they would shut down their ICBM program, which exists for one purpose, and that is to carry a nuclear weapon to the United States of America, and they would cease being the world's leading state sponsor of terrorism. Over the next 60 days, I'm going to do everything I can to mobilize and energize the American people against this catastrophic deal, because I think it is a profound threat to the safety and security of America, and we need a commander-in-chief that will defend this nation.
Senator Tom Boucher of Bedford, New Hampshire, is in the audience. He asks, tell us about a time when your judgment has been tested in crisis and what you want us to appreciate about your judgment.
Well, you know, I'll tell you, serving in the United States Senate is an interesting experience. I have spoken a lot about what I call the Washington cartel. What is the Washington cartel? It's career politicians in both parties who get in bed with lobbyists, they get in bed with special interests, and they grow and grow and grow government. You know, the American people are frustrated. They're frustrated because we keep winning elections. In 2010, we won the House. In 2014, we won the Senate, and we don't have leaders who follow their commitments. And I'll tell you the sad reality. My time in the Senate, what I've tried to do more than anything else is two things. Tell the truth and do what I said I would do. Stand against the Washington cartel and stand for the 27 million Texans I was elected to represent. Now, when you do that, they beat the living daylights out of you. They smack you in the press. They come after you on every front. When you stand against the cartel, Democrats attack you. The mainstream media attacks you. Republicans attack you. But the only way we're going to turn this country around, stop the spending that's bankrupting our kids and grandkids, stop the abuse on our Constitution, the abuse on our liberties, is with a leader with a demonstrated history of standing up to the Washington cartel. It's not easy. But, you know, Jack, we've seen it before. We saw it in 1980. Ronald Reagan, the Reagan Revolution, with the American people at his back, stood up to the Washington cartel and turned the country around. That's what I've tried to do every day. It's what I intend to continue doing, and it's what I will do if I'm elected president.
Thank you, Senator Cruz. We'll see you in New Hampshire soon, I'm sure. Senator Marco Rubio, also joining us live from C-SPAN. Senator, good evening. Should medical marijuana be a narrowly written law, or is it okay to have conflicting laws in certain states?
I don't support the legalization of marijuana. I understand that individual states are going through the debate of its use for medicinal purposes. I know in Florida that debate's ongoing. And as long as it truly is for medicinal purposes, and even at the national level, goes through, for example, the FDA process that any other medicine would have to go through, That's something I'm willing to explore. What I do not support is the legalization of marijuana or any other additional intoxicant. This country is already paying a significant price for illegal use of drugs and even alcohol, which is legal. You talk about New Hampshire for a moment. One of the stories that has not been as reported nationally is the fact that many of the people who today that are dependent on heroin are because they became dependent on prescription opiates. And when it became difficult to acquire those prescription opiates through the pharmacy system, they unfortunately became hooked on opium and heroin in the streets as a result of it. And so I'm not in support of any additional intoxicants being legalized, something like marijuana. For medicinal purposes, if it underwent an FDA process and it was truly designed to be used as medicine, not as a way to get high, you know, that's something I would be willing to explore.
Senator Rubio, if elected president, what would your policy be for the undocumented aliens in the United States already? Some would say we can't realistically get rid of 11.
Well, I'm glad you asked that.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
That's right. Yes. So, first of all, this is an issue that everyone agrees what we have today on immigration doesn't work for America. I don't think anyone would disagree, for the most part, that it needs to be fixed. But it cannot be fixed in one massive, comprehensive piece of legislation. There is only one way forward on this, and it will require three steps, and they have to happen in the following sequence. First, we have to prove to the American people that illegal immigration is under control. It's not good enough to just say we're going to pass a law that will bring it under control. People demand to see it. They want to see the fence completed. They want to see more border agents. They want to see more drones and cameras and ground sensors. But they also recognize that over 40% of the people in this country illegally entered legally and overstayed a visa. And that's why we need an electronic verification system that employers must comply with or they will be heavily fined. And that's why we need an entry-exit biometric system at our seaports and airports, so that we know when people are overstaying visas and we can identify them. That is the key that unlocks the ability to make progress on anything else when it comes to immigration. Once we have done that, the second step would be to modernize our legal immigration system. We are the most generous country in the world on immigration. We admit 1 million people a year legally to the United States, but we do so primarily on the basis of whether or not they have a relative living here. We cannot afford to do it that way anymore. In the 21st century, legal immigration must be based on merit, on what you can contribute economically, basically whether you are coming to be an American as opposed to simply live in America. Once we've done those two things, I believe there is a reasonable way to address the fact that you have 12 million people living in this country or more who are illegally here but have been here for a long time. And they will have to pass a background check. They will have to pay a fine. They will have to start paying taxes. They will have to learn English. And in exchange for that, what they will get is a work permit that allows them to legally work in the United States and travel. And that's all they will have for an extended period of time. And then at some point in the future, we could have a further conversation about whether they're allowed to apply for a green card. But that is the only way forward on illegal immigration at this point in this country.
Senator, finally, how would you assess the mood or morale of America and Americans? It seems to me that we're a tired nation. The economy's not growing. The budget and the deficits are mounting. We have threats abroad. How and why is America where it's at right now, and what's the reason for it? How do we get fired up and feel good about the future for all generations of Americans?
That's actually the fundamental question of this election. This nation is at a pivotal moment in its history. The world around us is changing, and we need to decide what kind of country we will be in the 21st century. The reason why people feel so insecure in their economic lives is because our economy has rapidly changed. Today, we live in a country where the largest retailer, Amazon, doesn't own a single store, where the largest hospitality company, Airbnb, doesn't own a single hotel room, where the largest ground transportation company, Uber, doesn't even own a single car. We also live in a world that's rapidly changing. China's taking over the South China Sea. Russia's threatening the unity of Europe and NATO. Iran is on the verge of acquiring not just a nuclear weapon, but as Senator Crux pointed out, the ability to deliver it to the United States. And radical jihadists have now spread across multiple continents across the world, and some are even located here within the United States. The result of all these changes is it makes people feel insecure because they recognize that the old ways of doing things no longer work, but no one has outlined the way forward in the 21st century. What we need now are leaders that understand this new era, that have clear ideas, as I have offered, about how to modernize our economic policies to fully benefit from all the opportunities of the new economy, and also ideas about how to restore not just American prestige in the world, but our military power, our ability to stand with our allies, and our ability to anticipate crisis.
Thank you, Senator.
Before it develops and threatens the safety of our people.
Thank you, Senator. I appreciate that. We need to move on to round two now, and these are going to be shorter questions that we hope will show differences between the candidates here this evening. And at the end, we hope that each candidate will have 30 seconds to say whatever they want to you, the voters, in hopes of winning your support. We're going to stay with our guest in Washington and Senator Rand Paul. Senator Paul, your father, or we still have our senators in Washington, I believe. Your father was well known in New Hampshire in the early state senator. He campaigned quite a bit in New Hampshire. In fact, last time, I believe he came in second to Mitt Romney. Libertarian, contrarian, some would call your dad. How do you define your political philosophy and what drives you as a senator and a possible president?
Well, you know, I'm a constitutional conservative. I believe the government ought to leave the individual alone for the most part. I think the states ought to be left alone. I think really the only powers given to government were enumerated in the Constitution, and all the rest of the rights are left to the people. I think that war should be seen as the last resort, not the first resort. That's what Reagan believed. Reagan is seen as a great president who defended this country. I'll do whatever it takes to defend the country, but I'm not eager for war, and I will always look very judiciously and in a very personal way as to whether we go to war. I know a young man who lost both arms and a leg, and I don't think we should just go to war as if it were a game of risk. I'll look at war as something that we have to do on occasion, but what I would say is that it shouldn't be the first resort, it should always be the last resort.
And Senator, before we let you go, we're actually gonna have you give you 30 seconds now for anything you wanna say to the voters in New Hampshire, Iowa, South Carolina, and our national audience.
Well, I'm a different kind of Republican. I think we need a new GOP. I'm a Republican who actually is leading Hillary Clinton in five states won by President Obama. Why? Because I have been going places Republicans haven't been in years. I've been to Detroit, Chicago, Philadelphia, Ferguson, with a message that liberty, low taxes will help poverty, will help joblessness, and that a low tax, a low flat rate will bring jobs back, and that if we get rid of the regulations, America will be great again. And I think this message is resonating. I've also been for criminal justice reform. I think we've locked up way too many poor kids, and what we need to do is have justice where everybody's treated the same under the law. And I think if we did that, we'll win the independent vote again and win. I'm the only Republican leading Hillary Clinton in Pennsylvania, and it's because I am different. So I embrace the fact that I'm different than the other candidates, but we haven't been winning. And if we try the same thing over again, we're not gonna win. So I am one who will put forward a plan and a message that is distinct.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Ted Cruz, would you agree that Republicans indirectly in Congress might have been blamed for the Affordable Care Act because they didn't come up with a solution sooner for the sliver of Americans that did not have health insurance? Had they, maybe Obamacare never would have been passed. I want to know your thoughts on that. And are there any parts of the Affordable Care Act that you think are worth keeping?
Well, there's no doubt we need common sense health care reform, and it's something you're seeing a lot of Republicans talking about ideas. I think health care reform ought to expand competition, it ought to empower patients, and it ought to disempower government bureaucrats from getting in between us and our doctors. I think the best way to do that, three concrete ideas, are number one, allowing people to purchase health insurance across state lines so that you can have true national marketplace and low-cost catastrophic health insurance. Number two, as Dr. Ben Carson talked about very effectively, expanding health savings accounts so that you can save for more routine health needs. And number three, working to make health insurance portable, delinking it from employment so that if you lose your job, your health insurance stays with you. Every one of those empowers the patients. You know, Obamacare has been a manifest disaster. The state of New Hampshire, insurance companies have put in this year for premium increases of 51%, in Iowa 30%, in South Carolina 33%. Millions of Americans have lost their jobs, have lost their health care, have been forced into part-time work. And I'll tell you, I've been proud to lead the fight to stop Obamacare in the United States Senate against the Washington cartel. And there are a lot of politicians in Washington that have largely given up. They don't believe Obamacare can ever be repealed, including, sadly, a fair number of Republicans. I don't believe that. I intend to make 2016 a referendum on repealing Obamacare. And if I'm elected president, we will repeal every word of Obamacare and we'll pass common sense health insurance reform to make health insurance personal and portable and affordable.
Senator, you now have 30 seconds.
58 years ago, my father fled Cuba. When he was standing on the deck of that ferry boat, looking back at imprisonment and torture in Cuba, he looked forward to the promise of America, to the incredible freedom that this nation provides. His story is all of our stories, all of us. The fundamental DNA of what it means to be an American is we are the children of those who risked everything for freedom. And that freedom, that promise of America, is in jeopardy. Working men and women, their lives have been made harder under the disaster that is the Obama economy. Our constitutional liberties are under assault. I believe in America. And if we can believe again, if we can come back to the free market principles and constitutional liberties that made America great, we can turn this country around. I believe 2016 is going to be an election like 1980. And as Ronald Reagan said, we will win by painting in bold colors, not pale pastels. That's what this election is about, reigniting the promise of America.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Marco Rubio, Senator Rand Paul spoke tonight about his feeling that the government was going too far in trying to collect data and information on possible terrorist activity, even against individuals if they were innocent. Do you think that he made, or that effort to do that, to get away with that data mining, made this country safer or less safe? And do you also, second part of this, do you trust no one in the federal government will misuse our phone and internet records?
Well, let me just say this. As a member of the United States Intelligence Committee, almost on a daily basis, I review the threats that are coming at our country. And suffice it to say that we are living through a period that is increasingly more dangerous than any we have ever lived through before. All the attention paid to ISIS, and rightfully so, it's not just ISIS. Al-Qaeda still exists. In fact, it's an organization looking to remain relevant. And the best way for them to remain relevant in their minds is to conduct a devastating attack against the United States. The al-Nusra Front is growing in power within Syria. The Khorasan Group is actively plotting attacks abroad against the United States and our allies and our interests. And all these groups actively are engaging and trying to recruit and inspire radicals located within our own country to kill Americans and attack our interests here and abroad. These risks are serious. They are not a game. And in my mind, it's not a question of if we're attacked. It's a question of when we're attacked. And when we are, the American people are going to want to know, why didn't we know about it and why weren't we able to stop it? So we need every tool at our disposal. And we have lost information we used to have. Just in the last 4 years, I have seen us lose access to information because of unauthorized disclosures that have made it easier for these terrorists to evade us. Do I believe that someone in the government could potentially violate this one day and use this information for wrongful purposes? If they do, they should be prosecuted and thrown in jail. No one has yet offered a single example of where that's happened, but if it ever does, we have laws for that. People should go to jail, they should be convicted, and they should be put away and punished for having done it. But I can tell you, the threats to America are real, and we better take them seriously or we will answer for it.
Senator, you now have 30 seconds.
Well, thank you for this opportunity. You know, it's a decade ago, 2 decades ago, my mother was a maid at a hotel. My father was a bartender working banquets behind a portable bar in the back of a room. And tonight, I, his son, am a candidate for the highest office in the land. The journey my family made from behind that bar where my father stood to where I sit here tonight, that journey is the essence of the American dream. It's what makes America different. It's what makes America special. And the reason I'm running for president is because I still want us to be that country. I still want us to be the country where people can do for their parents, for their children, what my parents did for me. And that's why tonight I ask everyone watching for your vote. Together, not only can we save and rebuild the American dream, but we can leave for our children a new American century.
Thank you, Senator, and our senators in Washington. Now back to our candidates here in New Hampshire.
And our Dr. Ben Carson has written 8 books and served on the board of directors for the Kellogg Company and Costco Wholesale Corporation.
Welcome back, Dr. Carson.
Thank you.
Some would say that the two biggest challenges or responsibilities of American president are deciding when to send troops to war in harm's way and naming a Supreme Court justice. I'd like to ask you about the latter. What would your criteria be? What kind of person, what kind of philosophy would you pick as a Supreme Court justice?
I would be extremely interested in what their past judicial history had been. Interestingly enough, you don't have to be a lawyer or a judge to be a Supreme Court justice. But, you know, your history tells a great deal. And, you know, using litmus tests, using questioning, probably will never get you to where you need to be. So looking at what they have done before, making sure that they truly understand the Constitution and what their role is in the judiciary would be very important.
As you look ahead in this process and all the Republicans running, how important is an event like this to you tonight where you can come into a state like New Hampshire and be part of this versus a national event where they're looking at national polls this early in the process? And do you worry about that and also big money in politics? What has to change for Americans to feel that they, voters like tonight, actually are getting heard and responded to versus other interests?
Well, I think these kinds of forums are obviously very important, particularly for individuals like me. 50% of America still doesn't even know who I am. Probably a little better after tonight. But you know, we will continue with that. And you know, I am absolutely thrilled to have an opportunity to let people understand that our country was designed up for and by the people. And there was never any intention that the people who were our representatives should have to be of the political class. They could come from any class. And I appreciate the work that many of my colleagues have done as governors, as senators, and other representatives. But the fact of the matter is, the experiences that made America to a great nation came from a whole broad spectrum of people. And it is our talent and our ability as people that will make this a great nation once again.
In our first round, you were just touching upon tax reform, and just a moment on that, or a second before we go to your 30 seconds, if you want to finish the thought.
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of people say, you know, the guy who made $10 billion and he paid $1 billion, he's still got $9 billion left. He can't do that. We got to take more of his money. That's called socialism. And, you know, that doesn't work very well. And what made America great was we had just the opposite attitude. We said, this guy just put in $1 billion. Let's create an environment that encourages entrepreneurial risk-taking and capital investment so that next year he can make $20 billion and put $2 billion in and grow the pot for everybody.
30 seconds to say anything you want.
You know, our nation is in a lot of trouble. We have tremendous divisiveness going on. There's a war on women, racial wars, income wars, age wars, religious wars, you name it, there's a war on it. We have fiscal irresponsibility that threatens to undermine our foundation and destroy the future for our children, and we have a failure to lead, which allows other forces to get in there, to grow, and to threaten our future. And we need to recognize that these are American problems. They're not Democrat or Republican problems.
Thank you, Dr. Ben Carson.
During his tenure, Governor Scott Walker has eliminated Wisconsin's $3.6 billion budget deficit without raising taxes or massive layoffs.
Governor, do you support increasing the age of eligibility for Social Security beneficiaries if it's phased in over time?
Well, I wouldn't touch Social Security for people who are at retirement age now or near retirement, but I think for my age, for my generation and those younger, yeah, we're going to have to make some reforms going forward. It's part of the process, though, when you look at things like Medicare, Social Security, you need to protect those for people at that age. And then for Medicaid, it's something that needs to be sent back entirely to the states without strings attached, where it can be done more effectively.
I want to ask you, because I asked a few of your colleagues tonight, can you win this election against the Democratic nominee and be truthful about entitlement reform when some critics will say you're anti-senior, anti-kid, anti-human, to try and save some of these programs that arguably are going bankrupt?
Well, I've won three elections in 4 years, the last two of which I won after a lot of people were upset on the Democrat side of things, and we did it by making big, bold actions and got results because of that. I think in the end, I'd love to go against whether it's Hillary Clinton or Joe Biden. I'm a new, fresh face versus a name from the past. I'm someone from outside of Washington with a proven track record, and most of all, I've gotten things done in a blue state.
30 seconds for anything you want to say.
Well, first off, thanks for hosting. It's great to be back in New Hampshire. And I want to say we're blessed to have a wonderful group of Republicans running for president. Sometimes people ask me what makes me different. Well, I've fought and I've won. I didn't just win 3 elections in 4 years in a blue state running for governor. We've actually won on the big issues. We balanced our budget. We cut taxes. We defunded Planned Parenthood long before these videos came out. And we did so, and we went forward in a way and took on the big government special interest and put the power back in the hands of the people. If we could do it in Wisconsin, it's not too late there, and it's certainly not too late for America. I ask for your vote.
Thank you, Governor.
Thanks, Jack.
During Rick Perry's time as governor, Texas created almost 1/3 of all new private sector jobs in the United States.
Governor Perry, in the past, you've mentioned cutting federal agencies. We've talked a lot tonight about the debt, size of government, not working for the rest of America. What specifically, what agencies would you either eliminate or cut?
I've heard this question before.
I thought you might do it.
Listen, I think it's really, when you look at the federal government, obviously, when we talk about the size of it and the concept of being able to shrink the size of state government. If anybody gets up on the stage, whether it's any of these capable candidates here or anybody on the left that says there's any way to go forward in this country without cutting and without growing, those are the two things that we must do in this country. And we have to cut spending. And I know a little bit about cutting spending. We had a $10 billion budget shortfall in my home state in 2003, Jeb. And we went in there and we made those cuts and we told people that we would do that because we realized that's exactly how you have to live your life. And the government has to learn to do that as well. And the states that have been successful, governors have done that and they've gone in and they made those cuts. We cut that $10 billion out of our budget and then we cut our regulatory climate down. We made it fair, we made it predictable. We passed the most sweeping tort reform in the nation, Joe. And the result of that was health care that exploded across the state. Of Texas, and we had the access to health care. And 2 years later, we came back into session, because we only meet every other year for 140 days, we had an $8 billion budget surplus. That's what you can do in this country. I believe in this country, and I believe that if you put those principles into place, that the greatest days of America are in front of us.
Governor Perry, I've heard several primaries that people want to run for president with good intentions. They say, we need to reform the tax code. It's too complicated. Can we really reform the American tax code for individuals?
And we start with a corporate tax code. As you've heard here tonight, we got the highest corporate tax code in the Western world. There are two things to make that growth occur in this country like it's never happened before. As I said earlier, it is with American and North American energy policy. And I'm talking about all energy policy in this country and all domestic energy sources. We need to be using those because you drive down the cost of electricity by this abundant power that we have. Couple that with this corporate tax. You lower the corporate tax policy or the corporate tax rate by 10%, and every accountant worth their salt will tell you that you'll see a mid-level wages increase between 5 and 10%. The other side of that is it's incentive to manufacturers. We can bring back manufacturing in this country like we've never seen before. Blue-collar workers ought to be standing up and saying, Perry, I'm going to vote for you because you're going to raise my wages. And that's what this is all about. We're going to be going out and laying out a positive message for the people of this country where that they see that the best days of America are in front of us, and it happens by using domestic energy and by creating a climate for manufacturing like we've never seen in this country before.
Are you going to have an individual tax reform plan? And if so, just
yeah, we'll lay it out, and it's obviously going to be one that, listen, you got to cut. You got to cut. I mean, whether it's cutting spending or cutting tax rates, that's part of it. And if you don't see the growth side of that with it, then you're just not paying attention.
You have 30 seconds, Governor.
Greatest days of America in front of us. I believe that with all my heart. I'm an incredible optimist about the future of this country. And I'm optimistic about this country because I understand it. I've seen what we've done before. I think about 1979, and this country was on its back. We had a president that was hollowing out our military. We had a president that put this country in malaise. We had our embassy that had already been taken over in Tehran. But 10 years later, we saw the Berlin Wall fall, And we saw Soviet communism on its way out because we elected a president that believed in this country, that understand that when America's strong, the world is safer. And that is exactly what we're looking for again. We've made it through two world wars. We made it through a Great Depression. We made it through Jimmy Carter. We'll make it through Barack Obama. Trust me.
Thank you, Governor.
You're welcome.
Governor Jindal's education reform efforts cut the number of failing Louisiana schools in half, while the state's high school graduation rate reached an all-time high.
Governor, I don't know how realistic it is, but when presidents or people run for president, they say, the first thing I'm going to do, the first executive order I'm going to sign, but I'm going to ask the question anyway. What are the first two executive orders you would push through or sign?
Well, Jack, the first thing we can do, even without Congress, is to get rid of this president's unconstitutional executive orders, granting amnesty and other areas where he's ignored the law. Secondly, I think it's important to get with the joint commanders, get with our Pentagon leaders, announce to the world America is coming back. We are going to stand with our allies like Israel. We're going to deter our enemies. We'll tell Iran they cannot become a nuclear power. We will tell Russia we will stand with Europe. They will not be allowed to come into Eastern Europe. We will tell China we will be there with our Asian allies. We've got a lot to do domestically. Yes, we've got to repeal Obamacare. Yes, energy independence. Yes, a lower, flatter tax code. We have to rein in the EPA and the regulations. First two things, even without Congress, repeal the illegal amnesty and other executive orders. Secondly, meet with the military. So we're not going to hollow out the military. America's coming back. Our allies can trust us again.
Governor, there are these things in this day and age called super PACs. Some of the candidates here, maybe you, each have one. I think an individual contribution today, maybe $2,500 or $2,700 someone could give to your campaign. Do you think these super PACs, where someone can give $10 million on the Democrat or Republican side of the aisle to a certain candidate, are good, okay? Should there be change on campaign finance?
A couple of things. One, I'm glad that this is an election, not an auction. And I'm glad that the voters in New Hampshire, Iowa, and the other states get to pick our nominee. Look, I'm for free speech. I'm not for limiting free speech. I think when it comes to campaign finance reform, the best disinfectant is disclosure. Let folks know who's giving the money, and then let it be a contest of ideas. But I don't think the candidate with the most money necessarily wins. I think Hillary Clinton may have as much as $2 billion. I think the American people are smart enough not to elect her as our next president of the United States.
You have 30 seconds to say anything you'd like.
Well, look, we thank you, first of all, for having us today. This is the most important election of our lifetimes. This is about the future of America getting off the path towards socialism. You've heard a lot of great talk tonight. The reality is we've got a great talker in the White House already. If talk was what we needed, we'd be on easy street. We need a doer, not a talker. We can't afford four more years of on-the-job training. I've got the backbone. I've got the experience. I've got the bandwidth to get us through this. I'm asking you not to join just my campaign. I'm asking you to join a cause. Let us believe in America again. Let us leave more opportunities to our children than we inherited from our parents. A lot of candidates running that are great talkers. We've had 7 years of a great talker. Let's elect a doer. God bless y'all, and thank y'all very much.
During his tenure in the Senate, Senator Graham led the charge to cut spending, reform entitlements, and get government out of the way of job creators.
Senator Graham, John McCain was on my radio show, Senator McCain, on Friday, touting your foreign policy experience. And I think he said, of all the candidates running, you may have the deepest experience.
Well, so when he's right, he's right.
Well, let's let's put that.
That's not always, but he was this time right.
Let's put that to the test.
Sure.
And I won't even mention a candidate who's not here. Is there any scenario you think, seriously, if your generals and advisors were saying, maybe we should have gone earlier. It's going to take some air, special forces, ground troops. But if we go into some places in Syria,
yeah,
we can knock ISIS back. If you know so much about this, even with allies, is that a smart thing to do? And why aren't we doing it if it is?
Well, you've got a weak president who is more worried about campaign promises, unfortunately, than is dealing with the threats to our country. He was told by all of his commanders, don't leave Iraq without a 10,000 force, residual force behind. John McCain and Lindsey Graham begged him not to. And everything we said has happened. You know, it's hard. Democracy's hard. Look how hard it is for us. If you expect these people to get everything right in 10 or 15 years, it's not going to happen. He was told by all of his advisors, Jack, you need to help the Free Syrian Army while Assad was on the ropes, a no-fly zone. He said, no, thank you. He said ISIL was the JV team. He drew a red line against Assad. Assad crossed it, and everybody in the region thinks we're just all talk. You're going to need more troops in Iraq. I've been to Iraq and Afghanistan 35 times. I humbly ask you to make me Commander-in-Chief of the finest fighting force on the planet, because they need somebody who knows what the hell they're doing. I've been on the ground 140 days as a reservist. You could see all this coming. I'm optimistic, but it will not be easy. We're going to have to go from 3,500 to at least 10,000 to get Iraq in a good spot. But if you don't deal with Syria, we're going to get hit here. It's the perfect platform to attack us. There is no ground component in Syria. We spent $500 million to train 60 people. I'd go to the Turks, to the Egyptians, to the Jordanians. I would go to Saudi Arabia and say, we're going to take your armies, and we're going to integrate our forces in your armies, and you're going to pay for this war. We paid for the last two. But we're going to pull the caliphate up by its roots, and we're going to hold the territory to repair Syria. If we don't, they are coming here. There is no easy way forward, folks. We're not going to balance the budget without Democratic support. We're not going to fix immigration unless you get a bipartisan plan. I'm from the reddest of red states. My biggest sin is that I've worked for Democrats to try to not only secure our border, but find a rational solution to deal with 11 million people. Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill saved Social Security by working together. After they had a drink, maybe we need to drink more in Washington. But I would suggest to you the best way to predict what I will do in the future is what I've done in the past and whatever it takes to defend this country.
Before you have 30 seconds, what should the federal minimum wage be?
The federal minimum wage should not be increased. And Hillary Clinton's list is a mile long of help the middle class. The middle class is somebody who can't go on vacation when the car breaks. The middle class is somebody who has to make hard choices that nobody else seems to make anymore. I've been there. Her definition, Secretary Clinton's definition of flat broke is a little different than mine. If after two terms in the White House and your husband's been president, you think you're flat broke, boy, have you lost your way. Okay. At 22, I was flat broke when my parents died within 15 months. I can't wait to get in the arena with her or Joe Biden, who's a fine man. But if you want to turn around American foreign policy, the last two people you ought to pick is his vice president and his former Secretary of State.
Real quickly, 30 seconds, Senator.
The next president needs to be sure of who or he, she, I'm sorry, I can't talk. The next president needs to have their act together. Three problems: too many terrorists, too much debt, too few jobs. You need a strategy to put radical Islam in a box and nail it shut. I don't see how we can do it without more troops. The debt's driven by the 80 million baby boomers who are going to retire in mass, of which I am one. We're going to wipe out Social Security and Medicare if we don't do something about it. I would do anything to save this program.
Thank you, Senator.
I would do whatever it takes to save this country. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Good evening.
Under Ms. Fiorina's leadership, Hewlett-Packard grew to become the 11th largest company in the United States.
What can Washington do to prevent another financial crisis like the one we saw in 2008?
Well, this is a classic case of where the political class failed. So the financial crisis was caused by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, government-sponsored entities that have been supported by both Republicans and Democrats alike. They have never been reformed. 25 federal government agencies were supposed to be minding the store. They didn't. Democrats passed Dodd-Frank. Dodd-Frank has caused what? 10 Wall Street banks too big to fail have become 5 even bigger, more powerful Wall Street banks, and thousands of community banks have gone out of business. This is an example of crony capitalism. So we need to repeal Dodd-Frank, just like we need to repeal Obamacare, but we also need to get about what we should have been doing years ago. Reform Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. The government should not be in the mortgage business, and have government agencies who are supposed to be regulating the financial system be competent at their job. Not, as we know from IG reports, have federal government regulators supposed to be minding the banking system, watching pornography all day long, and earning the same pay, pension, and benefits as somebody trying to do a good job. This isn't rocket science, folks. It just never seems to happen.
Senator Graham just had some pretty sobering words about perhaps Iraq, Syria, troop commitment. I think Americans, I can't even begin to characterize what it's like to watch the beheadings and the torture and what ISIS is doing to captives. But we also know about lone wolf terrorism now, Chattanooga, Tennessee, and so forth. Fort Dix. Do the American people, in your mind, have the stomach to, even if it's a limited war, to go to war over in Syria or Iraq again to fight this evil?
You know, President Obama has continuously provided to the American people a false choice. The false choice is this: either you agree with what I'm doing or not doing, or the option is to go to war. It's not true. There are many things we could and should be doing. First, we must have the strongest military on the face of the planet, and everyone has to know it, which means we have to invest in tooth, fighting men and women, the tip of the spear, and we need to reform tail, bureaucracy in the Department of Defense. Secondly, on my first day in the Oval Office, I would make two phone calls. The first would be to my good friend Bibi Netanyahu to reassure him we will stand with the State of Israel. The second would be to the Supreme Leader of Iran. Realistically, he might not take my phone call. He'd get the message. The message is, until and unless you allow full, unfettered, anytime, anywhere inspections, we will make it as difficult as possible for you to move money around the global financial system. Why do I start with those two things? Because knowing more world leaders on the stage today than anyone running, with the possible exception of Hillary Clinton, only I didn't do photo ops, I know that our allies need a message from us, that we will stand with them, and our adversaries need a message from us as well. We will confront you. In terms of ISIS, we have allies who know this is their fight. King Abdullah of Jordan, a good man I've known in many years. The Jordanians, the Saudis, I know the Saudi royal family, the Egyptians, the Kurds, the Kuwaitis, the Emiratis, the Bahrainis. All of these people know ISIS is their fight. But they've asked us for very specific things: bombs, materiel, sharing intelligence, weapons. So I'd hold a Camp David summit and ask them what they need from us. Yes, they may need more special forces, but we need to show leadership, resolve, support, or our allies will lose courage.
You have 30 seconds.
I started out as a secretary in a little 9-person real estate firm, went on to lead the largest technology company in the world, and now I'm running for the presidency of the United States. My story is only possible in America. But our nation is at a pivotal time. Whatever your issue or cause or festering problem that you hope would be resolved, the political class has let you down. Margaret Thatcher once said, "I am not content to manage the decline of a great nation. Neither am I." We need a president who understands the economy, the world, how it works, who's in it, bureaucracies, how to hold them accountable, cut them down to size, technology. I have a proven track record of challenging the status quo and problem solving. With your support and your vote, I will lead the resurgence of a great nation.
Senator Santorum was a member of the Gang of Seven that exposed the congressional banking and congressional post office scandals.
Senator, what should the president's role be in determining abortion policy in America?
I believe that the Supreme Court of the United States has abused its authority, most recently in the gay marriage case. Justice Roberts said it best. There was no constitutional basis for this decision. They also said that the same case was for Roe versus Wade. They said that it was the same kind of logic that was used in the Dred Scott case. So whose side are you going to be on? People who decided the Dred Scott case and Justice Taney? Are you going to be on the side of Abraham Lincoln? Abraham Lincoln, in his inaugural address, his first inaugural, said that decision cannot stand, and they actually went on and passed a bill to free the slaves. Are we suggesting that we're going to be held by a Supreme Court that Abraham Lincoln wasn't held by when an unjust, unconstitutional decision is handed down? In my opinion, we cannot be.
Is it time, this is from one of our folks, a voter, is it time to put a woman on the $20 bill, and if so, who?
Carly's a pretty good choice. I like Carly. There you go. Put Carly on the bill.
I thought you were going to say Mrs. Santorum.
Well, okay, yeah, now you're going to get me in trouble. Okay, Karen, I'm putting you. That's what I was thinking, actually.
Let's shift gears, but do you agree it's time?
I think that's certainly appropriate. We have tremendous people, women of great accomplishment. I have no problem putting them on currency.
Maybe why is it taking this long? Do you support the Marketplace Fairness Act from another voter, Marketplace Fairness Act, which would require internet businesses to collect sales taxes?
I do not.
What is going to happen if this push continues? How do we get across the message that taxing the internet might actually stifle business?
Well, look, I mean, that comes back to what we don't need is more government taxes. What we have to do is do what I'm suggesting, which is put forth a dramatic simplification of the tax code, go to a flat rate, go to a simplified system where you don't have any of the bells and whistles, no incentives. You don't need incentives if you have a low flat rate, and that's what we're going to do.
I hear, Senator, on my radio show from small business owners who just feel, even at the local level, state level, federal level, overregulated, overburdened, overtaxed. Some generational family owners say they wouldn't even start the business today. Have we become anti-business in the United States of America?
One of the things I've said is everything that President Obama has done with a pen and a phone can be undone on day one with a pen. I said this 4 years ago. I would suspend every single executive order, regulation, rules interpretation that cost Americans jobs. I'd repeal them if there was no purpose for them, or I would review them and make them more business-friendly and friendly to American workers. This is all about jobs. This is all about creating opportunities for the folks in America who feel that neither party cares about them. Neither party is talking about them. Democrats, all they want to do is give them money. Republicans, you know, all of our emphasis is all about small business. I think small business is great. We need to do things to encourage small business. But 90% of workers in America don't own or run their own business. They work for a living, and we have to have an idea and plan and a vision to put them back to work so they can rise too.
Senator, you have 30 seconds to address the voters.
As was mentioned, I was a member of the Gang of Seven. I won my first race in a 60% Democratic district against an incumbent. Second race, 70% Democratic district, took out an incumbent. Third race, in a state of a million more Democrats and Republicans, took out an incumbent. How did I do that? Because I was an effective reformer who stood for the people in this country, as I said before, that no one else was standing for. I'm the only person in this race who ran in a presidential year where the president on the ticket lost the state and I won. President Bush lost by 4, I won by 5. No one has done that. It's hard in a presidential election. In fact, none of these gentlemen, as accomplished as they are, have ever won in a presidential election year, particularly in a tied against you. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want a winner, you have to have someone who's going to stand with the American people, who has a record of reform and accomplishment to get things done, and I have that record.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
As governor of Ohio, Governor Kasich has turned an $8 billion shortfall into a $2 billion surplus and cut taxes by $5 billion.
Governor, what's a major issue with which you'll say tonight you disagree with the Republican Party, your own party, on? Where's your party wrong?
Well, I'm not here to criticize my party, but what I will tell you is I think that economic growth is not just an end unto itself. I think it's very important that with economic growth comes responsibility and ability to help people who live in the shadows, whether they're mentally ill or drug addicted. We have the mayor of Manchester who's fighting a tsunami here. We are all over the country, or the working poor. And what I've tried to emphasize is that economic growth, the creation of jobs, is our most important moral purpose. But once that is being accomplished, we need to reach out to people who have traditionally lived in the shadows. And in my state, Ohio, where we usually find out what the results of a presidential election are 3 days later, I won the second largest electoral victory in modern Ohio history with 60% of women, 51% of union households, and 26% of African Americans. Our whole purpose has got to be to give everybody a sense that the American dream is alive, that we all can rise. Whether we are drug addicted or mentally ill or developmentally disabled, whether we have never been given the attention that we need as made in the image of the Lord. So I wouldn't disagree with any of my colleagues on that, because I think we all have a heart for that. But it's something that I think our party needs to talk more about so that people across this country understand that we get them. Sometimes, Jack, our problem is people don't necessarily think we get them. But you know, thank God that my father carried mail on his back, that his father was a coal miner, that my mother as a mother could barely speak English, is because you're in touch with folks, with their anxieties and their concerns, and people want to know you get them.
Governor, in a few nights, I believe Thursday night in Cleveland, Ohio, there's going to be a debate on Fox.
LeBron's going to be moderating it, I understand.
I'll leave that. And I'm not sure if you're going to be in that debate, but you're here, and I thank you for that. But you got into the race arguably late, later than a lot of your colleagues here. There's some pretty impressive folks. Why did you feel there was that opening for John Kasich again? You've run before. You've run for president before. Why did you get in this time with such a large field?
Well, Jack, look, I've received blessings. Most of us here have been very, very blessed. And when you get that way, you have to figure out what your purpose is in life to make the world a little better place. It took me a while to get in this, because I didn't get in this just to do it. I get in it to win. And if I didn't think I could win, I wouldn't do it. And the reason I'm doing it is
frankly, I've been a servant in terms of government, you know, government responsibility a lot of my adult life. I had spent 10 years in the private sector, but I got a calling back to my state to help fix my state. And guess what? We went from the loss of 350,000 jobs to the gain of it. Our credit going up. People living in the shadows have hope. We've cut taxes by almost $5 billion. So, you know, and we've diversified our economy, Jack. The most important thing is to give people a sense that we get them, that everybody can be included, and that we lift everybody, nobody cut out.
Governor, you have 30 seconds to address the voters.
Well, I've been listening. You know, balancing the budget, everybody says, how are you going to do it? I was the chief architect. We did it. And when I left Washington, we had a $5 trillion surplus. The economy was booming. We cut taxes on risk-taking and investment. Senator Domenici and I were partners in that endeavor. So it's not about what I think we can do. It's about what I've already done. I served on the Armed Services Committee and have great respect for, of course, Senator Graham. I was there when we changed the way the military operates to get the services to work together to reform the Pentagon. I have national security experiences. In Ohio, we went from $8 billion in the hole to $2 billion in the black, a growth of 350,000 jobs, and people in Ohio, hope has come back to the Buckeye State. Thanks, Jack. I love being here. We'll see you again very soon.
Thank you, Governor.
As governor, Governor Christie achieved passage of a 2% cap on property taxes and landmark public employee pension and health benefit reforms.
Question I asked someone earlier, Governor, is a question about the president's now, maybe he regrets it. Imagine he does, calling ISIS a JV team, and now they're a bigger threat. Do you have a plan, if elected president, to take on that direct terrorist organization and defeat them, or is it a movement that we have to be realistic, some people in a bad way, it's going to be here for longer than we may want?
Well, I think the answer is yes to both. This is going to be a long battle. Whether you're talking about ISIS or Al-Qaeda or the other radical Islamic forces across the world. But the plan has to be very direct and very clear. We need to get our allies in the Middle East engaged in a major way, and we've heard that tonight from others as well, and I agree. The Jordanians, the Egyptians, the Saudis, the Emiratis, they want to be engaged. They believe this is an existential threat to them. And so we need to make sure that they're armed sufficiently. We need to make sure they're trained down to the battalion level. We need to be sharing human and electronic intelligence with them on a real-time basis, and we need to be providing them with the type of air cover and cooperation that makes their attempts to target these folks absolutely correct.
You may get the energy award of campaigning in New Hampshire. I've heard a lot about your town hall events. I hear you stay late, you answer the questions. That's the whole point of
participating. Yeah, I'm like the bad relative you invite for Thanksgiving, you know?
No, that's fine.
I come early and stay till they clear the
ditches. We want all the candidates in New Hampshire staying long and often. But some people observe this, say that, you know, your best time to run may have come and gone. I'd like to know what makes a lot of you personally tick to make such a big decision with you and your family.
Jack, you saying I'm washed up?
No.
Oh, God.
No. But, I mean, if you're gonna open the door, yeah, well, I'll take it. You know, you've gone through some battles in New Jersey. I'm sure it's a family decision for all the candidates to run for president. I think it's an incredible undertaking. Why now? What was the decision in the Christie household?
Listen, no one should run for president of the United States so they can look in the mirror and say they're ready. And when folks approached me 4 years ago, I was really honored. But I looked in the mirror and I said, I'm not ready. Not ready to be president of the United States. I've been governor for about 16 months in New Jersey. I was not ready. And so I look this time, 4 years later, in the mirror, and everything that's happened to me in the last 4 years, both good and bad, have made me better, have made me better prepared. And so the decision is about whether in your heart and in your mind, you're ready to lead the greatest country in the world during some of the most difficult times we've ever faced. And if that answer is not unequivocally yes, then you have no business going in front of the American people and asking them for their vote. I'm ready.
Well, ready for 30 seconds?
Sure. I come from one of the bluest states in America. It's been 42 years since New Jersey's elected a Republican to the United States Senate. Longest streak of any state in the nation, yet in 2009, against an incumbent that spent me $33 million to $11 million. We beat John Corzine, took on an $11 billion budget deficit, balanced it, cut taxes $2.3 billion. And now, after 8 years of no private sector job growth in New Jersey before I became governor, 192,000 new private sector jobs. But most importantly, what the people in New Jersey know is that when I say I'm going to do something, I do it. And when I'm saying I'm not going to do it, I won't. We need that kind of clarity in the United States again and in the Oval Office. I ask for your vote. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Governor.
As governor of New York, Governor Pataki led through the worst terrorist attack on American soil on September 11th, 2001.
Governor, that introduction or a second one is actually where I was going to go. It seems like a lot of years ago in some respects, and I imagine for you and others it probably seems like yesterday.
It seems like yesterday.
How did that change your life?
It changed my life completely. On September 11th I was the governor, and it wasn't an abstract thing to see and hear about radical Islam. I walked the streets of Lower Manhattan. I felt the flames. I could taste the dust and the ash in the air. Comforted families who had lost loved ones. And I vowed then that I would do, if I ever had the opportunity, everything I could to protect us from radical Islam and another terrorist attack. Sadly, we are not doing that today. ISIS poses a very clear threat to us, not just with a major attack, but what they're doing here, tweeting, recruiting jihadists. We just had the tragic incident in Chattanooga, and the Obama administration says we're going to not have our Marines put on arms, they're going to take off their uniform. My view is very simple. We cannot bow down to radical Islam anywhere, certainly in the United States, and we should have our Marines not take off their uniforms but put on their guns. We should be proud to be here. And we have to be proactive against ISIS in the Middle East. I went back and read the September 11th Commission report just a couple of months ago. And they had what we must do in the future to prevent another attack. And they actually had a section that said if, for example, Iraq becomes a failed state and radical Islam rises there, we have to use all of the might of America to destroy it. Well, today ISIS has training camps, recruitment centers, social media capability, hundreds of millions of dollars, people with Western passports. We cannot be passive. We have to arm the Kurds directly, their troops on the front line. We have to arm the Sunni and Anbar who are anti-ISIS directly, their troops on the front line. We have to, instead of telling Egypt, as Kerry did today, to get better at human rights, help their military fight ISIS in the Middle East. And by the way, Jack, we should go in and destroy those recruiting centers and training hubs before they have the chance to attack us here again.
Real quickly, lightning question. Is there a limit to Second Amendment protections in your mind?
I don't think we should change the Second Amendment at all. The problem has been mental health, and we have to do a lot more to enforce our mental health laws.
Governor, 30 seconds to the voters.
In my lifetime, I don't think I've ever seen Americans more divided than today. And a great Republican president, Abraham Lincoln, said a house divided against itself cannot stand. We need to win this election, but we need to do it not by polarizing for political reasons, but by uniting the American people behind good, intelligent, conservative, limited government policies. I know I can do that because I did it three times in the state of New York, the most blue state in America, with more than 3 million Democrats. We can win this election by bringing the American people together behind us. If I run, I promise you, I will do that and take America's government back for the people.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Governor.
While Jeb Bush was governor of Florida, more than 80,000 small businesses were started and 1.3 million jobs were created.
Governor Bush, Common Core curriculum has been controversial here in New Hampshire. Standards remain controversial. Should state and local school boards reject any so-called national educational standards?
They should. They should. States ought to create standards. They should be high. They should be state-driven and locally implemented. The federal government should have no role in the creation of standards, no role in the creation, indirectly or directly, in the creation of content and curriculum. The federal government's role in education ought to be to provide support for states that want reform. Governor Jindal has created some amazing reforms in Louisiana, but yet his Title I money can't be used to enhance those reforms. So the federal government should not have any say as it relates to standards. But we need higher standards. We need robust accountability, school choice, ending social promotion, a comprehensive plan to make sure that more than just a third of our kids are college or career ready.
I differ than my sister greatly on politics. You have a brother who's pretty well known and a dad. A father was president. Do you feel that when you're talking with voters, you have to differentiate yourself philosophically from the former presidents?
No, people get this. I mean, just by your point, if you're around a kitchen table, your sister doesn't agree with you on things, and so I have a different view than my brother. My dad is probably the most perfect man alive, so it's very hard for me to be critical of him. In fact, I got a T-shirt that says at the Jeb Swag store that says, my dad's the greatest man alive. If you don't like it, I'll take you outside.
Real quick, final word to the voters.
Sure. First of all, I'm really impressed with the caliber of the people that are running for president. Every person that has participated in this debate is far better than any of the Democrats running. And so I'm honored to be a candidate, and I believe that we're on the verge of the greatest time to be alive. We have to fix a few big complex things, and if we do, this country will take off, and I have the leadership skills to make
Governor.
It happen.
Thank you, Governor. Good night on our TV time. That's it. Thank you very much, everyone.
That will conclude this evening's program. Thank you to our participants. Good night.
Candidates come up just for the audience here and say good night when you come on up and thank you all. Let's thank our candidates and thank you all very much and the voters in New Hampshire.
Thank you.